The song said, if our God is for us, who can be against us? Do we understand what that truly means? There's no other force in this world that could truly stand against us. So here we go.
And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand?
God is stronger. The only reason our God is stronger is because he defeated death and the grave, and he lives today.
Thank you. Awesome.
My God is awesome.
Strength where I've been weakened.
And I'm broken.
been weakened.
Strength where I've been weakened.
Forever he will reign.
Forever he will reign.
Come on, say, my God is awesome.
My God is awesome.
Said he's awesome.
Awesome.
Serving awesome God, said he's awesome.
Awesome.
Yes, awesome.
Awesome.
My God.
My God is awesome.
Yes, he's awesome.
His grace is why I'm living.
Oh, praise his holy name.
Praise his holy
name. Oh, see, my God.
My God is awesome.
Do you believe it? Say awesome.
Awesome.
Yes, he's awesome.
Awesome.
Do you believe it? Say awesome.
Awesome.
My God.
My God is awesome.
Yes, he's awesome.
Awesome.
Yes, he's awesome.
Holy name. Praise his holy name.
Now sure do need him now. If we ever needed the Lord before, we sure do need him now. We need him every day and every hour.
We need him in the morning. 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 We need him in the night. 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 The sun is shining bright.
If we ever needed the Lord before, we sure do need him now. Oh, we sure do need him now. We sure do need him now. If we ever needed the Lord before, we sure do.
We need him when we're sad. We need him when we're lonely. We need him when we're burning. We need him when we're burning. We need him when we burn. Just to make our hearts feel glad.
If we
ever needed the Lord before, we sure do need him now.
Oh,
we sure do need him now. We sure do need him now.
If we
ever needed the Lord before,
my Lord,
we sure do need him now. We need him every day and every hour. We need him every day and every I'm in.
have the opportunity to come to this church to preach the word. And I never ever take standing in the pulpit, wherever it may be, I never ever take that for granted. The psalmist David declares in Psalm 122, he says, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Now, I don't know who the they was that said unto him. It really doesn't matter who the they is that gave the invitation to come into the house. It doesn't really matter whether or not it was an elder, a deacon, a preacher, but I was just glad when they said, and watch this, they said, let us. So whoever invited David into the house didn't just say, go to church, but went, ooh, Father, but went to church with him. Spirit of God is in this place, and I know we're going to be blessed today. We'll share a song, and then we're going to worship a little bit. Go ahead.
purity. Holy, 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 all the saints adore thee. All thy works shall praise thy name in earth and sky. Said, you are God in three persons. Oh, blessed, you are God in three persons. Oh, blessed. Said Trinity.
I call you holy, your name is holy, you are so holy to me. Let me hear you, I call you holy, your name is holy, holy you are, and holy you'll be, yeah, yeah, yeah. I call you holy, your name is holy, you are so holy to me. Let me hear you, I call, hey, holy you are, and holy you'll be. I call you righteous, your name is righteous, you are so righteous to me. Oh, I call you righteous, your name is righteous, righteous you are, and righteous you'll be, yeah. Now, I call you all that, your name is all that, you have been all that to me. I call you, your name is you, and all that you'll be. One more. I call you healer, your name is healer, you have been healer to me. Let me tell you, I call you, your name is healer, healer you are, and healer you'll be.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditation and thoughts
of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Amen. It's time for the word now. And it's important to have a word because the Bible declares that faith cometh by hearing. And hearing by the word of God. Somebody on this men's day needs an incremental increase in their faith. I gotta tell you that as I have gotten older and have accepted where I am in my life, and it's important that you use and recognize the word accepting where you are in your life, because sometimes when we fail to accept where we are in our lives, we do things with our lives that we once used to do, could do, but are no longer physically able to do. So it's a good thing to accept where you are in your life so that you modify your behavior according to where you are in your life. So you modify how you dress. And I've come to understand that the significance of the end of time in which we are fast approaching, the significance of the last days in which a conclusion to the human drama and saga will occur is rapidly approaching. And there's a tendency in our world and in our society, and particularly in the Church of God, there's a tendency to emphasize in this eschatological era the focus on upcoming end time events. So as a church, the Seventh-day Adventist church, we like to focus on the soon return. And we have a series of signs of the times that we use as markers to indicate the proximity of Christ's return. And we use these as markers to indicate the fulfillment of the promises of God and the word of God, so that the sun will be darkened and the moon will become like blood, and there'll be famine and earthquakes in diverse places. And in the midst of these hard signs, are some softer signs. Stay with me, I'm going somewhere. In the midst of these hard physical signs, there are some softer signs. And the softer signs reflect the moral decay that will occur just prior to the second coming. So the Bible talks about
people marrying and giving in marriage, and men being lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God. Usually, on days like this, which just happens to coincide with Father's Day tomorrow, and we make our calendar so that it does coincide, usually on days like this, I don't take pleasure in preaching on days like this, because for the most part, it is simply a verbal assent, and it is simply a mere acquiescence of the relevance of men. So we give the men the props for the day. But after the day is gone, we are relegated back to our previous role. And it's not just Men's Day. We do this on Women's Day and Deaconess Day and all these other days. We highlight the day, and we feel good that we highlighted the day. So normally I don't like speaking for days like this. But as I've gotten older, I have come to realize that the end is more important. The end, as important as it is, finds its significance in the beginning. Stay with me. The preacher is going somewhere. Don't get lost. So that whereas in the past, Men's Day was simply a day on the calendar, as we approach the end of time and there is increasing moral degeneration, and as we approach the end of time and the awareness and the value of men is being diminished, it becomes more than necessary not to simply acknowledge men on a calendar day, but to recognize that as we approach the end of time, it is the purpose of the enemy to cause and to devalue men. It is the purpose of the enemy, as we get closer to the end of time and the ushering in of the kingdom and the appearance of Christ, I'm here to tell you that it's not about Men's Day, but that Satan is systematically trying to confuse men so they don't know who they are and what they're all about and what they are to do. So then the significance of today is not just to recognize Father's Day and men in the house, but to get us to recognize that in a world in which the moral fibers and values and definition of a man is being challenged, we as a church have a responsibility to restore and redefine who. We have a responsibility to restore and redefine who a man really is. Now, if the significance of the end lies in the beginning, hold on. If the significance of the end, even though our society wants us to focus on end events, the significance of the end lies in the beginning. Are you with me? You see, when I bake a cake, I may enjoy the end product, but the end product is dependent on what I put in at the beginning. Society says, don't worry about what you put in, just worry about how the cake tastes. Don't worry about what happens before, just deal with the end product. But I can't just deal with the end product, because I've got to realize that the end is significant only because of the beginning. So in this time when students are graduating, that diploma that they receive in their hand is the end product, but the real significance is the beginning. Hold on. Are you with me? We celebrate the end, but the significance is in the beginning, because you can't graduate if you never entered. So then, preacher, if I want to understand what men should do and be, and if it is the responsibility of the church in this time of confusion in which the values and the duties and responsibilities of men are being shaped and fashioned by the social network, hold on, in which we are getting our cue from the magazines, and we're getting our cue from the Facebook and the internet, and we're getting our cue from the media. My Bible says that in order for me to understand, I don't need the researchers from Harvard. I don't know the researchers from Yale. I need to go back to the Word of God. And the Bible says that in the beginning, God. If you want to know who you are and what you're all about, you've got to go back to Genesis. Satan don't want you to go to Genesis. Because if I can block your understanding of your beginning, then I will cause you to miss your purpose. And if you miss your purpose, then you lose your... So the Bible says that God knelt down. I'm going to the beginning. You got to understand this. Black man, you got to understand this, because your origin is not on the plains of Africa. Hold on. You're bigger than that. As important and as grand as the continent is, well, I feel like preaching this thing. The Bible says that God, who had the capacity to verbally create man, just like he had created the birds and created the earth and the sky and the fish, the Bible says that God abandoned his usual creative mode. God abandoned the usual. He abandoned the usual because he was now getting ready to do something that was unusual. So the ordinary creative process had to be abandoned in light of what he knew he was about to do. So he didn't call us into existence, men. Because from the very beginning, even before you came along, he wanted you to know that you are special. You're not like the birds. You're not like the beasts of the field. So he abandoned the other ways in which he brought things into existence to let you know from the very beginning that what is about to come forward is special. So don't let the evolutionist, with his theory of a conglomerate mishap of events that brought you into existence, cause you to forget that you were made by God, and therefore, since you're not happenstance, you are special. So God makes man. And watch this. After he formed man from the dirt and the dust of the earth, you know, God is something else. No, he really, 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 really is. You see, he could have made man out of gold. He could have made man out of some precious metals, but he made man out of dust so that no matter what height the man may reach, he would have to recognize that he is from dust. You can get education, but you're still from dust. You may have a big house, but you're still from. You may be good looking, but you're still. You may have money, but you're still. You may have a position in the church, but you're still. No room for cockiness. No room for arrogance. And watch this. Whenever you get too arrogant, God just reaches in and begins to make the particulate matter of dust that was cohesively held together. He begins to cause the particulate matter to disintegrate. Brings things into your life that peels away the pride. Brings things into your life to cause you to recognize that you are who you are by the mercy and grace of God. So he'll take away physical attributes, and he'll take away family stuff, and he'll take away finances. He'll do whatever it is to get you to recognize that you're from the dust. So watch this. He kneels down, God does, and he forms and fashions a man. The man exists. Kennedy, the man exists. The man exists. But even though he exists, he's not alive until the Spirit of God breathes into him. You can exist without God. You can exist. You know, there are a lot of folks who are existing without God. But you will not be alive until the Spirit of God is in you. You can exist. Many people are just existing. But Jesus says, I've come that you have life and have it more. Why?
Why would he say, I'm come that you have life, if you already have life? Jesus. You can exist without God, but you can't live a fulfilled life. So watch this. Existing simply means surviving. Existing simply means we make ends meet. And there are many of us in the house, men in the house. We are simply making ends meet, and we're simply getting by from God wants more for you and your family than you simply making ends meet. He wants you to live. Now watch this. Man existed without the Spirit of God, and he existed in a favorable place. He was in the garden, a favorable place, existing without God. So my location and place is not an indication or a reflection of my relationship with God. It just simply is a place. He was in Eden, a beautiful place, a productive place, a fruitful place. When God is in you and the Spirit of God resides in you, it doesn't matter the place. Because after man sinned and he was escorted out of the garden, he was now in a less favorable place, but now he did more than exist. Because even sin now, hold on, even sin now, because the Spirit of God was in him, even sin now, because of the provision that was made before. Because of the provision that was made before he even sinned. After he sinned, he was in an unfavorable place, but he was still alive. One of the things you Christians have to get, you've got to get to the point in your lives, I'm very serious about this, in which you stop looking at the place where you are and the situation that you're dealing with. You've got to look beyond the garden, whether you're in the garden, a favorable place, or outside of the garden, an unfavorable place. It doesn't matter, as long as the Spirit of God is in you. The place doesn't matter. Let me take this story deeper. Since then, in order to be alive, I'm dependent upon the Spirit of God entering into me. It stands to reason then that the purpose of my living must be for the Spirit. The purpose of my creation, why he took the time to breathe into me the breath of life, is so that I, the creation, would be connected with the Creator. And when I fail to have that connection, then I fail to meet my purpose. So above all, the Spirit dwells in me to make me spiritual. And when I am not spiritual, I am not fulfilling the purpose for which I was. So, in order to understand what your role is as a man, you've got to first recognize that you are more than a man. Hey, are you with me? You've got to recognize that you are a spiritual being. That you are more than a man. That you are a spiritual being. Therefore, you must nurture the Spirit and be in communion with the Spirit. Now, men are typically viewed as strong and virile and tough. Came by to tell you that in order to understand the beginning, you've got to look deeply into it. The Bible says that after God made the man and he breathed into the man his spirit, and man became a living soul, God recognized that there was need for the man to go to sleep again. He was asleep. He breathed into him the breath of life. But in order for man to fulfill his entire purpose and being, God had to put him to sleep again. Because God recognized that if he left the man just as he was, the man not only would be lonely, but the man would fail to recognize the completeness of his personhood. Hold on. I'm going to get deep with it. Can I get a little deeper with this? So God, the Bible says, causes man to go into a deep sleep. And when man is now in a deep sleep, he, with his finger as a scalpel, incises his skin, pushes aside the muscles of his chest, reaches in with the same hand. The same hand that formed the woman is the same hand that he now reaches into the man and takes a rib out of the man and fashions that rib into a woman. Hold on. When he was done with the process of extrication and fashioning, the woman was now standing next to the man. Can I touch you? Bless you. You can't take out what was not in. You gotta get that. You cannot take out what was not in. So God is trying to tell us macho men who feel that our word is law, and what I say goes. And God is trying to let you know that in every man, there's a little bit of woman. In every man, there's a soft side. Don't let the the world calls you to hide the soft side, the nurturing side. It's okay to cry a little bit. It's okay to embrace a little bit. It's because it's in you. Society says it's not. God says, no, watch this. It requires deep sleep. It requires deep sleep. Because some of us have been so schooled for so long, men don't cry. But we hurt just like you do. And it's all right to let my boy see that I can cry. Doesn't make me less of a man. Because in me, you came out of me. So in me is you. Now, some of you women have too much men in you. I'm just saying. Ooh, Lord, have mercy. Have mercy. I will not be here for Women's Day. I'm just saying. No, you know, really, am I lying? Got some sisters that are just way too strong. And that's not simply meant to be humorous. It's not simply meant to be humorous, although there's humor in it. The significance of that is, if you want me to be a man, let me be a man. Give me a chance to flex a little. I may not do it when you want, how you want, but let me try. Can I talk a little bit? Some women got too much. Now this is important because a lot of times one of the problems that we have in relationships is because we have women trying to be men and men who don't know that they are men. Now, oh, Holy Ghost, Holy Ghost, Holy Ghost, Holy Ghost, Holy Ghost. And if you happen, ladies, to be married to a weak, namby-pamby, soft, whatever. I noticed I didn't say man, whatever. At least, watch me, at least in public, at least in public, pretend, make everybody believe. Now you know when you get home, it's a different story. But in public, at least let them believe that I'm in charge and I'm the man. It's all right not to tell the truth as a Christian every now and then. Show me some respect. I'm on the job. I'm not getting none. Show me some at home. I'm in church. I should get some. But show me some at home. Bible says that Jesus is the King of kings and Lord of lords. You got to remember, he's the King of kings, so I am a king. Hold on. Huh? King of kings, I'm a king. I don't have much land, but I'm still. Now, having said that, you brothers who are kings, make sure you treat the women like. I know you'd like that. I know you'd like that. Because the issue of respect is dual. And that means, and the brothers are not going to like this, but that means when you are with your woman, your eye, hold on, oi. When you are with your woman, you see, you've got to know how. You see, God made the women pretty around you, but you got to learn how to. You see, when you're young and young, you don't know no better, so you turn your head out. Now when you get older, you just kind of, you know, you got to know how to look. Oh, do I have any, why am I the only one who take a peek out the corner? You got to take a peek, but you don't turn your head all around the place. You gotta show your queen respect. Huh? You can't be whispering and trying to get digits in the presence of your queen. And you silly women who tolerate that. Oh, child, I ain't worrying. He's mine. He going home with. No! Don't even tolerate that. I don't care because he going home with me. You allow that to start there. Guess what? Where's going? I know these are church people. I don't need to say these things, but it's true. Because the reality is that the level of unfaithfulness in the church is startling. So God puts within us men a nurturing capacity that we need, and I have a problem with it. I'm West Indian. No, I am West Indian. Prayer box, I'm sorry. I'm West Indian. I'm West Indian. See, and West Indian men, we're brought up. Kiss my son. Hug. No. You see, why y'all looking at me like I'm the only one? Men created by God to nurture, and we're created to provide, and we're created to protect. Can I tell you something? See, God knows what he's doing when he makes all of us the way he makes all of us. You see, had God made me 6'5", why y'all laughing? Stop it. This is a serious sermon. Stop it. Had God made me 6'5 and 200 pounds in my youth, I wouldn't be here now. You're not hearing me. Because when I was younger and dating my wife, there were some boys who would step up to her in my presence like I wasn't even there.
And because of my diminutive stature. See, God is preserving some of us. Because I'm going to tell you, my instinct, regardless of my size, is to protect that which is mine. And God didn't bring boys who were my size. He brought bigger boys to step to my... Why did God bring bigger boys to step to my... Why did he do that? When I get to glory, I'm going to ask him, why did you bring... But because of my diminutive size, all I could do was talk the talk. You see, I would say, hello, can I help you? You know, and every once in a while, if they got too aggressive, I'd be bold enough to say, what do you want? With the hope. With the hope, preacher, that they would not respond, that my posturing would be sufficient. God is good. I'm still here. God is good. All right. Let me wrap this up. The children of Israel are facing a crisis. They are being attacked, and their existence is being threatened. God raises up one man in Judges chapter 7. God raises up one man by the name of Gideon. And through that one man, he assembles an army. And he assembles the army to fight the Midianites who are threatening the very existence of the nation. Through this story, God begins to reveal that the men of Israel are also created not just to nurture and protect and provide for their family unit, but that the men of Israel are ordained and called to protect the church. He calls the men to arms because the battle is raging. And when the battle is raging, it's time for men, Holy Ghost, it's time for men to step up. When the enemy comes in like a flood, it's time for men to step up. But not all men who are called, are chosen. And not all men who are assembled in the camp are chosen. They're all in the camp. 10,000 in the camp. But they're not all chosen. Because all God needs is a few. Oh, Holy Ghost, just a few good men. And the criteria for the selection
of the good men lies in how they drink the water. You know the story. First, he weeds them out. Those of you who are afraid, those of you who are worried about your job, and those of you who are worried about what folks think about you, you just get up and go, because we don't need those kind of men. As funny as that may sound and seem, and may appear to be contradictory to the widespread invitation of the gospel, all ye come. All ye come. Yes. But when it's battle time. All right. So he selects the men who kneel down by the riverbank and lap the water like dogs. You know the story. Ends up with only about 300. Just a few good men. That's all is needed. But the characteristic of their goodness did not lie in their valiance on the battlefield. The characteristic of their goodness lied not in the courage that they displayed. The characteristic of their goodness lied in the fact that they knew how to be on their knees. It's not the modality of drinking the water, whether they lapped it as a dog or not. That's not what God was looking at. That's what we are taught to believe God was looking at. God was looking, however, for individuals who were used to being down on their knees. That's what God's looking for. Men who know how to pray. Just a few good men who know how to pray in time of crisis, in time of battle, in time of difficult situations, in times when the family's being pulled apart here and there. Men who know how to pray. Some music guys, come now. I'm going to ask today, like Gideon did, if there's some men in the house who know how to pray. Pray for their children and pray for their families and pray for their wives and pray for the church and pray for themselves. If there's some men in the house who know how to pray, I'm going to ask you to just slip out of your seat and line the walls of this church right now. All of y'all who know how to pray. I'm not asking for the little boys, because this ain't about boys. Boys will become men, but I'm talking about some men. I don't want you in the front. I want you to line the church. Go all around. Just a few good men. Now watch me. Watch me. We shall overcome. Spread it out. Spread it out all around. Spread it out all around, no gaps. No gaps. There's some gaps over here. Spread it out.
connect it up, link it up, fill it up.
Let's sing the song, let's sing the song. Oh, 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 oh. Now we shall overcome. My God said, let me hear the men say, we shall overcome. Just us. Go ahead, man. Let me hear the basses. Bass.
We shall over.
Oh, all your men sound like that? Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Let the women hear the manliness. I do believe. Now, my spirit is feeling one other song, and I'm going to ask everybody to stand now. My spirit is feeling one other song.
We've come this far by faith, oh, oh.
Message today. And I'm very sure, even though we're standing today, men, there are some of you along the circle. You're not members of this congregation. Maybe you're not Seventh-day Adventist. Maybe you're not practicing as a Christian, but today you want to make a commitment to God as a man. And you want to say, by His grace, I will follow Thee, my Savior, wherever You lead. Through Jordan's rolling billows, by your grace, I'll follow you. Is there one man in the house today that just want me to pray for you? Because you're saying, by his grace, I'm going to make it through. I'm going to make it through. Is there one man in the house today? You thought you wanted to do your own thing, but you want God to work mightily in your life. And you just want to raise your hand. Just raise your hand where you are, just for a moment. Is there a man in the house today that you feel that you want to make it through with Jesus? And you just want to wave at me just by raising your hand. Is there a young man in the house today that you want to raise your hand and you want to say, preacher, just pray that God will help me to make it through? Is there somebody? The Lord bless you down there. I can see you. Is there somebody else? Is there somebody else? The Lord bless you down there. By his grace, we're going to make it through. Is there somebody else in the house today? Amen. The Lord bless you. We're going to make it through. We're going to make it through. Is there a woman in the house today that by the grace of God you are saying, pastor, I want you to pray for me too. I want to make it through. The Lord bless you. The Lord bless you. The Lord bless you down there. The Lord bless you. The Lord bless you. Let us bow our heads, gracious Lord. Though the battle may be severe, yet we know who is the victor. Jesus Christ. So today, we leave ourselves into your hands. We say with the psalmist, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in time of trouble. Therefore, we will not fear. Though the earth be removed, and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, Lord Jesus, today we submit ourselves at your throne of grace and mercy. And we ask you that you'd help us to stand with the good men and the great women. We thank you for your grace, and thank you for the preacher, and thank you for the day, and thank you for the commitments. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. May God bless you.